everyone. Very happy to be here. I think some of you may have heard me before, so I have some material from the past, but I want to talk about something about the future. And I want to give you a sense of what I call ecosystem intelligence. Is this eco? Okay. So, let me start with where we are as a human race in terms of technology, right? And obviously, we are at a very, very special place. This has never happened before, that so many different kinds of technologies have come together, not because they needed each other, but independently, bottom up. And now we live in an age where we have connectivity, we have internet, we have devices, we have AI, ML, we have cloud, and we have IoT and all of blockchain and all that. And now the question is, obviously we don't know all these technologies, but we understand what they bring. And now the question is, how do we think about taking advantage of this ecosystem of technologies that we have, right? And the next generation of engineers and data scientists and product managers will have to create a new kind of what I call ecosystem thinking and not the traditional thinking. And this talk is really about what that means, especially in the context of products, applications, AI. What does ecosystem thinking means, right? That's kind of the theme of this whole thing. And hopefully through lots of examples, I'll be able to communicate that subtle idea, which is the next way of thinking about where technology and the future is going. Yeah. Now, every time we get excited about AI and we say, oh, I need to take some courses, there are thousands of courses out there, and each one has hundreds of different modeling techniques that we have to learn. And we start learning AI as a bottom-up thing, right? Let's learn SVM, then let's learn clustering, then let's learn this and that. And we kind of sort of are lost in that idea that is AI just a collection of models, right? And then implemented by various Azures and all that. Is there a structure to this? Is there a ecosystem of AI models and not just a collection of AI models? So I want to start with that itself, that AI is not a collection of models, it's an ecosystem of models. And what is that difference is what I want to highlight. So if I look at a top-down architecture of AI, yeah, instead of looking at a collection of models and say what is logistic regression and all that, if I say, independent of the industry, independent of the data set, independent of the business verticals, independent of the objective functions, is there a common framework that I can use to think about AI in any of these domains, right? And after 20 years of thinking about it, it turns out to be a very, very simple framework. And you've heard of this framework in many different ways, and I'm going to just share it in one of the ways. And for me, all intelligent systems are nothing but a stimulus response learning systems, right? Whether it is us as humans, us as learning to drive, or Alexa learning to understand speech, we are all the same, right? So the idea is, how do I capture all of AI in one picture? I want to start with that, and then take it to the next level. So if you think about how we operate, every company is making decisions based on stimulus data, right? So stimulus data is what you can sense. And in every industry, there's a lot of stimulus data, right? So if you think about Fitbit stimulus, right? IoT sensors in a plant is stimulus. All your SMSs coming from, your banking and credit card is also stimulus. Every time you click, Google search or like something on Facebook is also stimulus, or you buy something, right? So we are now in a world of sensors and a world of data, and stimulus data is the starting point of it. And now, what is the first creative process in AI is not, what is the data, therefore what I can do. The first creative process is, I don't care about what the data is, but given a domain, how do I think about the state of every entity in that domain? And for me, data science is actually not about data. It's really about the state thinking. So if I am doing retail, what does the state of a customer mean, right? Is he a loyal customer? About to churn customer? Is he a valuable customer? Is he a fraud customer? What is the state of the store? For every SKU, what is the inventory level? What is the cost of inventory and all that? For a telecom network, what is the state of the tower? Tower is an entity. What is the state of a customer? Right? For a car, which is an autonomous vehicle, what is the state of the car in terms of sensors? So sensor data has to get converted into a very small number of state vectors that says, yeah, your health score is this much, your cardiac score is this much, your mental health score is this much, your emotional health score is this much. So that is the first thing I think about when I think about AI is, what are the entities in my business? How do I characterize a high level notion of state of those things? So if you go to banking and finance, you don't think about transaction data, that is the stimulus data, but you start to think, okay, if I were to characterize a customer in a banking sector, what would I do? And you say, oh, I need a CIBIL score, I need a capacity score, I need a fraud score, I need this score and that score. And then you work backwards from the state thinking and say, therefore, what data do I need and what models do I need to go from stimulus to state? So that is how the AI journey starts for me. And then once you understand the state of an entity, the next thing that we need to do is to say, okay, if this entity is in this state, that means if a customer churn score is high, what do you do? If a customer loyalty score is high, what do you do? If a customer's, you know, cardiac health score is low, what do you do? So how do you convert a state into action is the second part of AI, right? So first part is machine learning, second part is data science in my world. And once you have decided what the actions are, how do you respond to that stimulus, right? And this applies to every business and every this thing. Now this I can code up as an IT system also. I can write up a bunch of rules, you know, and talk to a bunch of experts and say, how do you convert stimulus data into state and how do you convert state into action and all of that. This is not yet an intelligent system. What makes it an intelligent system is the feedback loop. And this is one of the most important innovations in the last 20 years, which is how do we collect lots of feedback data to improve my system of analysis? How do I convert or diagnose a disease of a patient is stimulus to state? What prescription do I give him is state to action? And if the patient gets well or goes to the hospital is the response. And how do I learn that maybe my diagnosis was wrong, maybe my reasoning was wrong, or maybe my synthesis of what medicines I gave is wrong, right? And how do I learn all that? And this continuous loop is all that AI is. And all the machine learning algorithms that we can think about are either your stimulus to state algorithms that convert, do all the clustering, demand forecasting, price forecasting, whatever, or they are, state to action algorithms. And that's all there is to AI. And when you start now looking at AI from that perspective, and now start to look at courses and modeling techniques, you will start to understand what is the role of a SVM classifier in this whole big picture. It's just a stimulus to state thing which is going to predict some score. And it's not by itself going to be useful. I need 5 such scores, and I also need to convert those state vectors to actions, right? So that's one way to look at AI as a single architecture. It's an ecosystem of models. That's why we have lots of them. So now you understand the idea of an ecosystem. Collection to ecosystem is what we are transitioning. Now, quickly, obviously we understand AI has come of age. There are a lot of AI capabilities out there, so we don't have to talk about them. You have heard of many of those. But where we are now is AI is at a 4-year-old level, where we can start to not worry about how can I improve speech further, how can I improve vision further. That people are still doing. What we need to start thinking about is, how do I use these AI capabilities along with all the other technologies to build next generation products? So now I will transition to a little bit of product thinking and how people have evolved the idea of what a great product is in the last 20, 30 years, right? So our parents' generation got excited about cars and TVs and fridge. And from an intelligence point of view, they were intelligent because the intelligence was programmed into them, right? You go and take your iPad into the sun, it becomes brighter. It's programmed intelligence. It has not learned it. So that is instinctive intelligence, and that's the first generation products we have built. The second generation products we have built in the last 20 years are what I call virtual products, which are really what I call crowdsource intelligent product. That means unless a lot of people use these products on a daily basis and give feedback, these products will not become intelligent, right? And that is one of the dilemmas of a startup today, which says, oh, I want to build an intelligent product, therefore I need data, therefore I need customers, but I don't have customer because I don't have an intelligent product, right? So this cycle has to be broken, and that is what the challenge of the Googles and the YouTubes is, which is how do you master the art of learning what we call implicit feedback and improve your systems without taking explicit feedback from the customer. And whoever is winning the market game is not about the revenue, but it's about the label data that they are getting and improving. So what we have learned in the last 20 years is take one or two machine learning ideas and build a very, you know, planet scale product around that. That's what we have learned in the last 20 years. But still, there's a lot more to go, right? Now we are talking about the next generation product, which is even more interesting and even more drastically different than 1 to 2. Any ideas? IoT is a capability. I'm thinking about products that will use all these capabilities that we talked about as a single product. And that's where our thinking has to evolve. So for example, if I look at a connected car ecosystem, not just an autonomous vehicle, I'm talking about a connected car ecosystem that can optimize all our joint commutes together, right? Or a connected home ecosystem. So here, what will happen is, and this is where ecosystem intelligence will start to come in, which is in product 2.0, people were using products and making the products better. Now imagine products are talking to each other, right? Your fridge is talking to your grocery and to whatever, and things are getting done because product to product communication is happening and they're learning from that, right? And optimizing that. So that's our next generation thinking. So data scientists will not be focused on how to build better speech and vision models anymore. They're going to have to start to think about how to build smart cities and how do you bring the ecosystem of APIs together to start thinking about those things, right? So let me talk about how do we transform our thinking into an ecosystem thinking, right? So one of the big paradigm shifts that is happening is that now we have mastered the art of building individual models. That is a done deal. We don't have to worry about that. That aspect of data science has been packaged. You can download any package, put the data in the right format, you get a model done. That is not where the role of a data scientist is anymore, right? If you want to keep doing that, start worrying about your jobs. Yeah? That's not the role of data scientists anymore. Now the role is, how do we think about building solutions that can combine these models together? So the first thing I do to my data science hires is, hey, first wear your design thinking and a product thinking app hat and say, you know, what do you want to build? And then work backwards and say, what models do I need, right? Instead of saying, oh, I know how to build a fraud detection model, right? That's not how we want to do things anymore, right? So one of the great lessons I learned when I transitioned from companies like Google and Microsoft into Ola was that there is this ecosystem thinking in the models we build within a company also. So if I have a bank and I have built silos of models, right? A fraud model, a marketing model, a churn model, a credit model, these are all independent models. If I'm doing Google search, I have a search model, I have a spam model, I have a ad model and all of that. These are all collection of models, right? YouTube recommendation. And that is great. That is one kind of thinking, and you can keep thinking your models in silos. That creates a lot of silos, data silos, model silos, platform silos. And now people are realizing that those silos are coming in the way. And now what we need is a different kind of thinking, which says a model is not an independent entity. It lives in an ecosystem of models such that its input could be another model and its output can go to another model. Right? So how do we think about the architecture of models and not just a collection of models? And that's the next thing we need to start thinking. So one example is when, let's say, Ola, Uber allocate a cab to a customer, the final model is an allocation model, but it also depends on whether the customer is ETA sensitive or price sensitive. That's a different model. Whether a driver is a, you know, rash driver or a nice driver, whether the passenger is a female passenger and all that, whether the ride is going to a, you know, lonely place or a crowded place. And these are all models. They feed into the next set of models and then we get something out, right? So like in deep learning, we have layers. Now think about layers of models doing different independent things and feeding into each other. So I keep asking companies, what is your AI architecture from this perspective, right? You have a collection of models. They are all great. They will keep improving over time. But how do they feed into each other? And that's when some of the models become state models, some become action models, and the whole system works, right? So we need to raise our thinking to ecosystem of model thinking. Yeah? So just to give you some examples, so one of my passions, and I did an edtech startup on this, is how to build a, you know, teaching machine, if you will, right? How do you scale education to the masses? So I'm not thinking how to build an SVM model, I'm thinking how to transform education. So I start with a problem domain, right? A big ecosystem. And I work backwards and say, what does it mean to build a new kind of education system in the digital AI era, as opposed to what does it mean to convert the current education system, making it AI enabled? These are two very different ways of thinking, right? So if we keep thinking, oh, I have an education system, let's improve it and make it more digital, all we get is Baijus and all of that and nothing else, right? But if we start thinking and say, no, this is not how to think, how do I disruptively think about education and say, look, education can have a digital part and a physical part, and I can completely separate the two, and my app and my tablet can be all of my digital things. So all my videos that I watch, all the homework I do is there. I never go to a building called school to listen to someone. Because if I can listen to someone on my app and pause and rewind and all that, why do I need to go to a school at a certain time, right? So I can study at my own, but what does it need to build such a system, right? So here are a few APIs of AI that we are going to need, right? And so we say, okay, if you have a tablet that can recognize formulas in chemistry and physics, handwriting, if it can understand language and images, right? That is one kind of APIs I need. Then I need an API to understand the student and the state of the student. We talk about the state thinking. So what is the knowledge level of a student in every concept? Can he apply the concept or just he knows the concept? What kind of mistakes he makes and what is the behavior of test taking and all of that, right? So how do I profile a student which is continuously changing? And then how do I personalize everything for the student, right? How do I personalize the curriculum? What you are ready to learn next is different from what the other person is ready to learn next, right? How do I personalize curriculum, content, problems, and even solutions? Maybe you are comfortable with one way of solving the problem because you know all those concepts that are needed. Another person is able to solve it in a different way, right? But what is happening today? We have one textbook, we have one way of teaching, we have one, you know, size fits all education, and it's not working out, right? And this is how we can think disruptively. And the fourth set of capabilities we need are capabilities like, how do you make the system more human, right? Human-computer interface, you saw how Neon has come up. So what about, you know, speech and conversation and gesture and emotion recognition, right? Now these are all very diverse capabilities. If you just build one of them, you are still not going to build the product. So how do we bring them all together? And this is the creative process of, you know, how do we think like a product manager and not just like a data scientist, and think about disruptive solutions in the next generation, right? Another example of what we are trying to build. So today what happens, you know, the farming is full of ignorance, right? Farmers don't really know what to do next, right? What crop to grow in their soil, if there is rain coming, what to do, should I put a fertilizer today or not, should I water my plant today or not, which part of the field should I water, which I don't want to water. So there's a lot of decisions that a farmer makes, and he's no help, right? Because if you just imagine the ratio of agriculture experts and the number of farmers, it's a huge gap. So now imagine a product where, you know, in any language, a farmer can ask the query, right? Punjabi, Gujarati, whatever it is. We have a speech-to-text and text-to-intent models. And then we say, okay, I have an AI-based agriculture expert, not a human agriculture expert. And it has also got the farmer profile. I know where you are from. I know what you have asked before. I know your farm size and soil. And I also have the knowledge graph of agriculture. Right? Agriculture has the largest knowledge graph in the world. And I have that. Not only that, I also have satellite data for, you know, your farm. I have the weather prediction and I have the soil IoT data for you, right? Now imagine in the world of sensors, in the world of knowledge, in the world of, speech and text, how can I deliver three things? I don't want to just deliver information. I may also want to deliver content and say, hey, you know, watch this video, which will show you how to apply this pesticide because it has a lot of, you know, rashes you can have and all that. So how do I create content think about that, and how do I deliver actions for him? If you don't have the fertilizer, can I deliver to your doorstep? If you're ready for harvesting, can I deliver a tractor or whatever to your doorstep, right? So people need three things, right? Information, content, and action. And how do you drive this as a solution thinker? How do you build solutions knowing that all these sensor technologies available to you and all these AI technologies are available to you. That is the next role of a data scientist, right? How do you build solutions like that? And obviously, you'll be an expert in one thing, and you're going to have to integrate with the other things. Now, another evolution in products that is happening is the personal assistants now, right? They are called chatbots, but I call them personal assistants. And what is happening is, if you look at your phone today, what happens? You look at your phone and it says, oh, I have like 200 apps, right? Apps for banking, apps for Ola, Uber, apps for Swiggy and all that. I have hundreds of apps and I'm looking for apps before I get to an app, right? And then, if nothing works, then we have Google search, right? So we have a backup plan all the time, right? So this is the world we live in. So we have become what I call a provider-centric society. That means if I want to watch a movie, first I have to go choose a provider, Netflix or Amazon. If I want to take a cab, first I have to choose a provider, Ola or Uber. If I want to eat something out, I have to first provide, you know, to choose a Zomato or a Swiggy, right? So we are not yet a customer-centric ecosystem, we are still a provider-centric ecosystem. And that's what the real purpose of a personal assistant is, which says, you don't care where I get you the product, or where I get you the food, or which cab you get, all you are saying is, here is a cab I want, right? So how do we go from these silos of, you know, apps, one does one thing good, to an ecosystem of apps which is going to be called a super app or universal personal assistant? And can you think of that as the new operating system, not Android? Think of a universal personal assistant as the operating system where everybody plugs in their APIs, right? So we go to the next level of abstraction and start thinking about what really the phone should look like. Yeah. So let me give you some examples, and you know, this happened to me, so I want to share this live example of what a silo does and what a non-siloed world will do to us, right? So, I don't know how many of you have heard of this kid, Lydian. He's a prodigy in piano, right? You can look him up. So, someone forwarded me the video, I loved it. I started watching lots of his YouTube videos, right? So, now, imagine this. YouTube knows that this person, Shailesh Kumar, is interested in piano, is interested in this person, this entity. It's not about the ID of the YouTube video, it's about the content. So we are saying this person is now having an interest in this artist, right? Or this kind of a music. So that is what YouTube knows, yeah? Now what happened was, few months later, this guy actually came to Hyderabad and he was doing a concert in Shilparama. Okay? Now that information is available with Book My Show. You understand? So I have Book My Show and YouTube both on my app, but they are not connected, right? They are in their own silos. Now, as soon as Book My App says that this event is about to happen, and if it is connected to my profile, which is stored in my universal personal assistant, created from multiple usage of different apps, I will now learn, oh, this person was interested in this artist. He lives in Hyderabad. His calendar says he has time for the concert. He has a payment gateway set up, and why don't I ping him and say, hey, this guy is coming, you want to book a show? And it just happens. Because I didn't, you know, today it is a serendipity that it will happen. Eh? If somebody told me or I'm looking actively, only then it will happen. So this is an idea of how do we break the app silos and create an ecosystem where there is a common layer of what a user is doing across apps, and then that common layer is, you know, talking to all the other apps, right? So can my YouTube activities, you know, if I'm interested in a certain song of a certain artist and that movie is released near my whatever, can I, you know, be pinged about it, right? So how do we think like that? And that is what ecosystem thinking is, yeah? Another example I'll give you, now we are going to build assistants, right? Alexa will build one and everybody will build one. Now today what will happen if we build an assistant which only works for you? So you are the person who is talking to the assistant, right? And the assistant is talking to the rest of the APIs out there. So that is the current model of thinking. But now imagine a world where assistants can also talk to each other. Yeah? So my assistant and my wife's assistant, we have given permissions that they can talk to each other, right? Now that's what we do. We do a little bit of these all the time, right? Like I share my WhatsApp, you know, on WhatsApp I share my live location to somebody. And we do this all the time, right? We share information in a live mode all the time, right? So imagine this scenario, right? So imagine two friends are talking and this one says, hey, want to go for a movie? And the other one says, yes. What should happen? What is really a smartphone? I want you to imagine smartphone is not just a bunch of clicks and swipes. That's not a smartphone. Let me show you what a smartphone is. Yeah? So now imagine the two smartphones have the personal assistants enabled, right? And because I'm talking to you, there is a, you know, there is a this thing, interaction starts, and it understands what I'm saying, right? The speech enabled, so it understands what I'm saying, it understands the context of the conversation, and then it's these assistants start to talk to each other. Imagine if I have a secretary and you have a secretary, and they start to talk to each other as soon as they know this is what we are trying to do. And now imagine those personal assistants says, oh, these are the movies this person prefers, these are the movies this person prefers. These are the locations where you live and you work or you go on the weekend. This is your calendar, right? And these are the movies I would recommend to this person versus that person. And these are the e-wallet information. Imagine that there is a way to share, you know, this thing. And now imagine there is a coordination agent which gets excited whenever two people start to talk. And his job is to collect all this information with permission. And he also understands the web, and it knows that, okay, I'm connected to Book My Show, I know where the shows are, and before you hang up the conversation, the system knows what movies both of you will like, what time that movie should be, what movie theater you will go to, and therefore, I'm going to book the cab for you and the tickets for you. So before you hang up the phone, the job is done. The chores that you do after that conversation, let me check my calendar, let me see what movies are online, let's coordinate, right? So imagine an ecosystem of personal assistants that can do this. Yeah, that would be a smartphone. Yeah, so this is where I think we need to start thinking, how do we create those kind of things? Yeah. Now let's talk about optimization. Another area that AI does is it does optimization of systems, but what happens is, we do optimization in a very narrow sense, right? So today, you know, if I have a complex system, like a whole telecom network in the city, if I'm just optimizing one tower without looking at the effect of that on the neighboring towers, I'm not doing a global optimization, right? If I have a retail system and I'm only optimizing recommendations and not supply chain and inventory, then I'm going to have a problem, right? So optimizing individual boxes in a system is creating a lot of suboptimal solution. So how can we think about optimization in an ecosystem way? And say, can I optimize the whole ecosystem as opposed to individual things? So one very interesting example is, this is what we do all the time, right? All of us try to optimize our own commute every day without knowing what others are trying to do. We have no information of that. Now imagine a connected car ecosystem which knows where you live, where you want to go, what time your office is, but it also knows what other people are trying to do, right? It has the overall information of your work and office, and now it does a global optimization for everyone and optimizes the commute and says, you should go at 8:15 and you should take this route. So imagine Google Map is now not giving the same route to everyone. It's giving a different route, and Google Map can now optimize at a city level and not just at an individual level. Today it only optimizes for your current commute. And that's why we still get stuck in traffic. Yeah? So, you know, a digital twin of a city, how do you simulate and then how do you optimize is now possible. Yeah? This lesson I learned when I joined Ola, and I was talking to a lot of people in Ola, and everybody said, if you solve allocation problem, will be great. If you solve sharing problem of cabs, will be great. If you solve pricing problem. And what was happening is, again, these optimization silos. Each one was trying to optimize their own little thing, and they were tinkering with their own knobs. And what was happening? Yesterday when I did this, it worked, my metrics went up. Today when I did the same thing, it didn't work. Why? Because the system is too complex and the interactions are so many that you cannot think about your own optimizations in isolation of something else. Because if you change pricing in a certain area, it'll affect the number of cabs that get allocated and people will not take the cabs, right? So now the distribution of cabs is affected, right? So you cannot optimize them independently. And after 3 months of talking to all these people, I realized that, for example, fleet management is like 100 times more complex problem than building a search engine. And the reason is, here you're not going to think about collection of models and collection of optimizations. You need to think of a single objective function that you're trying to optimize. Only then you will be able to optimize something globally, right? So then we scratched our head and say, what is it that all retailers, all fleet management companies, all agriculture systems, all, you know, Swiggies of the world, what are they trying to optimize really? Demand and supply, right? And not just demand and supply in all contexts. A context is a location and time in case of this thing, right? In case of retail, it could be the Kirana store or the whatever and the inventory of the product. So you can think about demand supply, right? Today agriculture is very inefficient because we don't know the demand, how much potato, how much onion we are going to need, you know, given that this is the, you know, demand forecasting from the last year based on the sales data of all the retailers, and therefore we don't know how to optimize the supply. And if we knew that, we would tell the farmers, don't grow onion, grow tomato, because you'll get a better price, because I know others are growing tomatoes and you're not going to get that, and I have now optimized globally the agriculture system. Today every farmer is making their own decision, which mandi to go, what to grow, what practices to use, right? So if you think about such resource constrained environments, right, where there are only so many vegetables, there are only so many cabs, there are only so many products in a store, how do you match demand and supply, and can you come up with an objective function and say, look, all of you, whether you're doing pricing or allocation or if you're doing supply chain or pricing in retail, all of you are actually optimizing only this objective function, right? Because if your supply is more than demand, you are reducing the price so that demand increases. So you are artificially creating demand by reducing the price. So you are actually solving a supply equal to demand problem, right? If you are doing whatever you are doing, allocation, you are again solving a supply demand problem. So the idea is, how do you think global optimizations, and how do you not think, let me solve pricing independently and this independently and that. So this is ecosystem thinking, and you know, how do we build that? Another idea of ecosystem thinking is, you know, what makes fleet management very complex is the following, right? So we now know how to build simple systems, right? I know now how to build a search engine. It's a very simple system. All I need to do is crawl and index and come up with this, you know, highly scalable and very accurate model for ranking, right? It's a single metric, single action kind of a system, right? So we know how to build those. We know how to build Amazon recommendation engine. We know how to build Netflix recommendation engine. We know all that. What is the next complexity in AI is when you have to build a multi-metric, multi-action complex systems. And that's what the journey from Google to Ola is for me, which is, how do I think about it differently now, right? So here is what the problem is, right? We talked about stimulus, response, action, and all that. So I'm going to do that in the context of fleet management. So imagine you have multiple entities, right? Customer is an entity, location and time, cross time is an entity, you know, cab is an entity and all that. You know the stimulus data each one is generating. So you have customer app giving you customer data, driver app giving you driver data, right? You have third party data coming in for the city and all that. You have internet to give you what events are happening in the city and so on and so forth, right? So you have a stimulus layer, but it's not a single stimulus layer. Google search is a single stimulus layer. What query you did, what result I show, what did you click on, how long did you stay on that page, that's it. It's a very simple stimulus layer. Here we have a very complex stimulus layer, right? Google search doesn't depend on weather or something, for example. Now, the first thing is we need to start thinking about state. And again, I have multiple entities. So what is a customer state? So I have to build a bunch of models that say he's a loyal customer, or we gave him a bad experience, his churn score has increased. So how do you think about every entity and all the state vectors you want to compute for every entity to create an overall state vector, right? So this is now a state vector across entities, right? So your driver state vector, your customer state vector, your location state vector, and so on and so forth. And now, the problem again is you have many, many levers. This is what makes a complex system complex. It's not that you have one lever. You have all these levers. You can give more incentives to drivers. You can give more incentive to customer, which driver. How do you, you know, ask the driver to go to that location and not that location, right? How do you price differently? So what makes a system complex? Multiplicity of entities, you know, the size of the state and complexity of the state, but more importantly, the interacting levers that you have. Search engine does not have that problem. What you do on YouTube, recommendation has nothing to do with what you do on search engine and what you do on Gmail, right? But here, these actions are interacting with each other, and that makes it very, very complex, right? And the last thing that happens is you also have interacting and metrics, right? So if you do the wrong allocation, a driver cancellation might go up, or a customer cancellation might go up, or your if you lower the price too much, your revenue will be low, right? So there are multiple metrics that are competing with each other, and they are not like correlated with each other. And because of the multiplicity of actions driving multiplicity of metrics is what makes this a very, very complex problem. Yeah, and you do this every so many times a day in the whole city, and then at the end of the day you measure all these metrics and say, what did we do? And obviously you are going to use that. The stimulus layer will also give you the metric. Stimulus layer will also give you state, and then you build this model, right? So how do you think of a complex system and machine learning in a complex system like that is the next way of thinking. Now, one more thing, I did, this is one of my pet inventions, if you will, which is, how do we think about two parts of machine learning? There is one part, which is causality. How do I learn the causality, right? If you eat this kind of food, what will happen to your health? If you don't exercise, what will happen? If you put too much fertilizer, what will happen? So there is a causality. This is your machine learning part, right? The stimulus to state part. And then the other is the optimization part. Now think in terms of these three things. You have state, you have defined the state of a customer business, you have a bunch of actions. The first thing we are going to do, we can do from this data, is that we can start to think about what is the relationship between, if I did this action, this combination of actions, in this combination of state, what was the combination of metrics, right? So that's the first kind of thing we learned. It's a very complex thing because they are highly interacting with each other. So you can imagine a deep neural network or whatever. The state vector is very large, the action vector is very large, and it's across the whole city, right? So you can imagine that. And how do we learn the causality? I don't want to improve causality. I just want to learn that if I throw this from here, it'll go down. That's all I'm learning. I'm not saying whether I should do it or not. So that is the first part of machine learning, and we learn causality. And then the real question is, so here, what is the training? The training is, given your state vector models, remember ecosystem of models, so you have lots of models for state and actions, and then how do you learn metric from it? And you have past data that says, I did this, therefore this happened, I did this, therefore this happened. I'm not saying you did the right thing or the wrong thing, I'm just learning causality, right? So this is the first part of your, how do you think about machine learning? But that's not the end goal, right? What is the end goal? Now, when you try to optimize such a complex system, you can have intuition and say, maybe we should increase the price here. Maybe we should do this. But this is not scalable and optimal. So what do? We go to the next level, which is optimization. So now I have learned causality. My causal neural network is fixed. What do I do next is a very interesting thing. So now imagine that your city is in a certain state. Right? All the cabs are where they are, all the customers are where they are, the demand forecasting and all that. So the city is in a certain state on a Monday at 9 o'clock throughout the city. Right? So you know the state. You also know the metrics you want to optimize. Right? So the boss says, look, my revenue is going down, we need to increase revenue. Or he may say, look, I'm not getting enough drivers, I need to make sure drivers are enough. Right? And all that. So it is easy to define metrics, it's very difficult to define actions. Because the interaction between actions to metric via state is a very complex process. So if you can define metrics, if you can observe state, can I now do an optimization? Reverse. So it's like an inverse function. So think of it this way, that imagine if I put certain action values in the action part of the neural network, it goes forward, it produces a metric and says, look, if you do this in this state, this will happen to your metric. Then I say, no, I want to increase this metric, decrease this metric. Then it does a backprop like embeddings, and it only affects the action vector and changes the action vector. And you do this a couple of iterations. You can now find an optimal action vector for a given state, given which metrics you want to optimize. Yeah. So this is how do you learn causality and optimization after you have learned causality. And in this process, you don't update the weights. Causality is fixed, and every day you can update that. So here, inferencing means, given a state and a metric, what should be my actions, right? So that's my optimization model. Okay. Now let me spend some time on you know one of the problems that I am looking at in the whole country now is how do you build an AI ecosystem in the country, right? So these conferences are great. We're going to learn lots of stuff from each other, but then what happens, right? Now, if you look at startups in any ecosystem, hundreds of startups in healthcare, each one doing one thing well, right? So I'm an X-ray startup. I can recognize with 99% accuracy what happens in an X-ray. I am a pathology startup. I am a whatever, right? Disease diagnosis startup. So I have 200 startups in healthcare. They're all working in their silos, and we are not able to change healthcare, right? Same thing in education. I have Byju's, I have this, I have that. And now I have hundreds of startups in, you know, some are content startups, some are reporting startups, some are, you know, school software startups, all kinds of startups or companies, but they're all working in silos and they're not thinking that ecosystem has to be changed and not just their models and their revenue and their exit strategy, right? So how do we build an ecosystem of AI where, you know, everybody can participate in a fair manner and actually produce, you know, value for society and not just ranking on a Kaggle competition? Yeah. So how do I transform from there to there? Yeah. All right. So obviously technology is as good as its use cases. So one of the things we need to start thinking is, well, we have solved Alexa use cases of increase the volume of TV with voice and everybody's happy that it is working. What next? Is that the use case we want to do, right? Or if you looked at Google I/O, how do you book a haircut appointment through chatbot? Is a Google I/O demo. Is that the use case of all this technology and GPUs and all that? And this is the best use case that we came up with, right? So the idea is first we need to go back to what use cases we need to solve in the Indian context. And you know, they are not going to be convenience use cases. They are going to be social upliftment use cases. How do we think about what are the areas we are passionate about and what are the problems and how do we work backwards and say what role AI plays, what role data plays, what role content plays, what role sensors play, what role cloud plays in this whole ecosystem, right? And work backwards and then we solve our little AI model, right? That we are good at. Okay, so how do we think backwards is one of the themes. Now, if I look at this moonshot, right? So imagine all these sectors in the country, right? So you have an education sector, a healthcare sector, and all these. These are important sectors that need help, right? With technology and all that. Let's pick one sector and work backwards. And say, within the healthcare sector, who are the people who are going to consume my products and services? So hospitals, patients, insurance companies, all of them are looking for solutions in the healthcare sector, right? So like in each sector, there are beneficiaries of those sectors. Then I'm saying, okay, if I'm focusing on hospitals, what products and services does a hospital need, right? So, you know, it could be digital products, physical products, sensors, whatever. And now if I pick one of the products and say, what services does it need? So it doesn't need only AI services. It needs user lake and user profiling, right? Electronic health record. It needs content of all kinds of, you know, doctor notes on different diseases, right? It needs a lot of software services, AI services, data services, sensor services, right? So there are different kinds of services we need. And if I go back from AI services and say, I'm a data scientist, I'm not a software engineer, what can I do to help? Well, within AI, there are many, many services that you need. So now you have speech services, vision services, knowledge services, and all that. And now you are saying, who's going to provide those services, right? And now you say, who are a producer of that AI, right? So I can say, look, there are big companies like Google's and Microsoft who will provide some services, but they are not going to provide all services, right? They're growing their base of services. Now, everybody's getting into healthcare and retina and all of that. Being a search engine, you're getting into healthcare, right? You understand the value of this transformation. But there are startups who are going to do the same thing. There are colleges who are going to build the same APIs. There are going to be students doing BTech project who are going to build the same API, right? Now imagine an ecosystem thinking where I can say, look, how can this student who has come up with a new way of solving speech to text in Bengali, he's a Kharagpur graduate, that's all he knows, right? He has two choices. He can join one of the speech companies or he can actually build that model and bring it to a marketplace. Like if I grow a potato, I bring it to a marketplace and somebody pays for it because it's a high quality, low price potato. Imagine a marketplace thinking in AI where anybody can democratically, with equal access to to consumers can put their AI services out there, right? Not to win a Kaggle competition, but to actually monetize and improve these businesses, right? Now the same students, same vision service can be used in healthcare, also in agriculture, also in somewhere else, right? So we are not building things which are highly coupled, we are building things across the silos. And now, how do we do it? So imagine a marketplace where there are consumers of AI, right? Imagine Ola wants to do, you know, speech-based driver apps in all Indian languages with all the noise in the background, right? Now, Ola is not a speech company. It has two choices. It can go get one of these big companies, you know, speech-to-text or whatever models and start using it and pay for that, obviously. And, you know, they may have it for Bengali but not for Gujarati and all of that will happen, right? So imagine consumers of AI on one side and producers of AI on one side. So I'm going to now look at the world in these two ways. You are either producing AI capabilities or you are consuming AI capabilities to build products on top of it. That's all we are doing in this world now. And now imagine an ecosystem or a marketplace or an AI exchange, like we have a stock exchange. We are building a data exchange in the country with NASSCOM and NITI Aayog. What about an AI exchange? So the idea is, imagine all speech APIs, right? Detect language, detect keyword, detect speech to text, detect accent, detect whatever, right? Similarly, all vision APIs, all question answering APIs, all IoT APIs. Imagine there is a marketplace like a mall where all APIs are available to a consumer. He doesn't have to go and say, oh, you know what, let me go to Google for that and Microsoft for that, right? Look at the app that he is building. Imagine he is coming onto the marketplace which enables all AI APIs for the consumer. There is standardized API. And now imagine all these producers are competing for each API that they want to compete for. So I am good at Bengali speech to text. I am a researcher or a student. What I'll do, I'll go ahead and upload my model into the marketplace. I don't want to worry about who's going to use it, customer base, data, revenue. I am just good at what I do. Can you enable me to reach to the millions of people out there, right? So how do we think like that? So now, so that is the concept that, you know, hopefully if this works out, what will happen now? Imagine that, you know, you are good at certain kind of thing and you have a new ideas. All you have to do is upload your model on a marketplace and as people will use it, they'll pay for the API at the top and you are going to get paid for it, right? Will you go to Kaggle anymore? No, right? Do you need like a big VC funding for all the GPUs and stuff? You are monetizing on day one because your model is good. Yeah? And the consumers are not worried about where to go for the models. I am now enabled on all APIs. So all hospitals are enabled on all medical APIs, right? Because there are hundreds of startups doing little things, one API here, one API there. Together, we have everything. Yeah? So let me show you a concept video of what is possible. Yeah? Hopefully, the audio will work. So this is a scenario where we build an app. Imagine somebody in the country built an app for fishermen, yeah? Okay, so I'm just going to play it. So this is a Machli app that we built, but imagine somebody built that.
What's your phone number?
Now, this app is speech enabled in English. Why? Because Google speech to text is available to me, yeah? But when I click on Telugu or Tamil, it does not speak to me. You understand?
Choose
because
language.
There is no API for speech to text in that, right? So whether it is this phone or that phone, that fisherman or that fisherman,
choose
they have
language.
An app and it only works when the English menu is clicked but not in Indian language. So imagine that situation. Now this guy is only interested in fisherman app. He doesn't know what is speech to text but he wants to, he talks to the farmer and the farmer or the fisherman says, look, I don't know what the menu is saying. I don't know how to read. So in the Indian context, we have to build a speech-first app, not a text-first app or an English-first app. Now imagine that somebody in the country, he has no idea what this app is. Somebody in the country goes to the marketplace and he uploads his text-to-speech model, speech-to-text model into the marketplace. That's all he's doing. He has no idea who's going to consume it. And now he has done it at his own pace. He doesn't know about any of the other apps that are going to need it. He doesn't need to know that. And now the same app, which was not working on Telugu language, is now working. Now it is reading all the menu items from the phone. So the guy who's just interested in fishery doesn't have to worry about speech to text and text to speech. He can just go to this platform, connect his API to this, and when somebody uploads a model, it will become speech enabled. Does that make sense? You understand the construct now, and if we work together, right, and say, look, I'm good at this, I'm looking forward to this marketplace coming out, and whenever it does, I'm going to plug in these models into the marketplace, and I don't need to worry about monetization, because if thousands of fishermen are going to call your APIs, then you're going to monetize them, right? Like Uber, Ola, we're monetizing. It's a two-sided marketplace, the producers and the consumers of APIs. Yeah? So that's kind of the construct and the idea. And what it'll do, it'll democratize the way we think about AI now. You don't have to be an expert or a PhD. If you have GPU and data, you can go ahead, build your model, and start to put them online. It'll be exhaustive. We are trying to make it as exhaustive. So, you know, healthcare APIs, speech API, whatever, right? Education APIs, IoT API. They're all in one place, right? They're consolidated in one place. And it's a fair marketplace. If your API is better than the other guy, you can charge more. That's how a marketplace works, right? So quality, benchmarking, all of that is part of this. And then it's an abstraction. So you don't have to change your app because now you switch from Google to Microsoft way of doing things, right? You are calling the same API of the marketplace, and the marketplace can, you know, takes care of all that, right? So you don't have to worry about who the producer is. It's like saying, you know, when you go buy a, you know, grocery from the store, do you care which farmer produced it? And that's what I mean by producer agnostic, right, world. And then, you know, you just have a transaction and blockchain and all that, we'll take care of it, right? And these models will continue to evolve as we go through that, right? And it'll expand to new APIs as the world discovers new ways of doing things. We'll keep expanding. And obviously, because there is an inherent competition in this whole thing, right? We are competing for that API. If my API is not good enough, I'm not going to make money. So I have always an incentive to keep improving my APIs, right? So that's one of the ways of thinking about how do we galvanize the AI ecosystem in the country, make all the products AI enabled without having a data science team for speech in Ola and Oyo and all these companies, right? We don't need it because there are producers. Today, what is happening? All of our speech people are distributed in all these companies, right? The banking company has a speech group. The Ola has a speech group, right? All these insurance companies have a speech group. So we are now in a weird state. The talent pool is limited and we are scattered throughout. And that's not even our primary job of that business, right? So how do we decouple producers and consumers and create a marketplace ecosystem for AI? Yeah? All right, so that's all I had. So hopefully you got a sense of what ecosystem thinking is and where AI is going to be heading, whether you're building a marketplace-like ecosystem or a product which is AI-enabled or AI itself, how do you think about an architecture of AI, right? So these are different notions of what is ecosystem thinking. All right, so I'll stop there and take any questions. Thank you.